Now let me introduce you to another very special person. In the short time we've been together here today, the theme of a global thinking and global engagement has come up already several times. You might say that our guest speaker, award-winning journalist and CNN international anchor, Hala Gorani, actually wrote that script when she attended Mason some 20 years ago as an economics major. I think we might see her in action. Impressive. Well, you're about to meet her. Hala was born in Seattle. She was raised in Paris, and now she's based in London as the anchor of CNN's The World Right Now with Hala Gorani. It's an award-winning international journalist, and she has served the world by providing information during her esteemed 17 years at CNN. Ms. Gorani launched her career by working for the George Mason student newspaper while earning her degree in economics. Yes. So she now has what would be considered the dream job for many of you. It all started at the Broadside on campus. She went on to write for AFP, the Agence France-Presse, and later worked for French network France 3 and for Bloomberg Television in London. At CNN, she has covered major stories around the globe, including the Syrian refugee crisis in Lebanon and a devastating earthquake in Haiti. She has reported from every country in the Middle East. In 2006, she played a pivotal role in CNN International's coverage of the Israel-Hezbollah conflict, for which CNN received the Edward Murrow Award. She also was among a group of CNN journalists who won a News and Documentary Emmy for the network's coverage of the 2011 Egyptian Revolution. Hala Gorani truly embodies Mason's global mindset. Her ability to connect with citizens around the world serves as an inspiration for all of us. We are so pleased to have her address her fellow patriots here today. Hala, will you please join the podium?
We're first going to give you your award.
I got it. Thank you. Because I think I skipped a step to make this official. I have to say the magic words. By the authority vested in me by the Board of Visitors of George Mason University, I confer on Hala Gorani the honorary degree of Doctorate of Humane Letters with all the rights and privileges thereunto belonging. Ladies and gentlemen, it is now a great honor that I present to you George Mason University's 2015 commencement speaker, Dr. Hala Gorani.
This is nerve-wracking, let me tell you. Trust me. Thank you, President Angel Cabrera, the faculty and staff, to the George Mason University Alumni Association, of course, to the members of the board, to Provost Wu, and especially to you, the graduates, your parents who put up with you all these years, supported you, the family and friends as well in attendance here today. Congratulations, you all did it! What a tremendous honor it is for me to be here. And my gratitude again to President Cabrera for extending this invitation, as well as for this honorary doctorate. Now, I know it doesn't technically entitle me to be called doctor, but I've kind of told my team in the newsroom already that I'm going to work it into the show title. Possible names I'm toying with. Doctor, doctor. Give me the news, right? The doctor will see you now with Hala Gorani. We'll be right back. Just kidding. No, I'm not. So you know when older people tell you that time passes in a flash and you're like, sure, whatever. Well, I've conducted an extensive 45-year investigation into the matter, and I can report to you that, yes, it does. I was sitting where you are literally half a lifetime ago, graduating with a Bachelor of Science in Economics from George Mason University. Go School of Economics, where are you guys? As you know, one of the best in the world, one that has employed on its faculty not one, but two Nobel Prizes, and economists quoted around the world. And also be proud graduates for this reason. More than a fourth of you are the first to graduate in your family. And I know they were mentioned before, but I know about these two guys because they were on CNN, as President Cabrera said. Your university has produced Seth Robertson and Viet Tran, who figured out a way, of course, to put out fire with sound waves, when I understand most people told you guys you were nuts, right? You went ahead and did it anyway. That news made it all around the world and started with these two crazy kids and a bold idea. Now, when I was at Mason, we definitely had parties where there was both fire and noise. But somehow, we never made the connection. But you guys did. So there I was, half a lifetime ago, sitting where you are on a hot day like today, which isn't too hot, but I wrote this 2 weeks ago and thought maybe it would be, with my whole life ahead of me. When I was asked to deliver this commencement speech to the graduating class of 2015, and first, after digesting the fact that it would mean addressing 7,000 people at once, reflecting on the honor it represented, I had to ask myself for the first time this question. What do I know now for sure that I didn't know when I was sitting where you guys are sitting? And it's a tough one to answer because when, like me, you're neither young anymore, but certainly not old yet, when hopefully you're halfway down the unpredictable journey that we call life, when there is still so much to learn and so much I don't know, to be honest with you, most days I'm the one who needs the good advice. But then I thought of this. Perhaps the most important thing to know right out of college is that whatever makes you different today, whatever is the root cause of some of your insecurities, all those things, and trust me on this one, end up becoming your strength. I'm a particularly complicated case, though some of you may be able to relate. I'm a woman. I was born in Seattle. I was raised for a bit in St. Louis, Missouri, then moved to Algeria in North Africa, then to Paris, where I barely spoke French, but was thrown in with hundreds of kids who saw very little in me, but someone who just wasn't like them. To top that all off, I'm originally 100% Syrian. And my name isn't exactly Western sounding, let's be honest. Put simply, I'm a foreigner wherever I go. In the US, I'm European. In France, I'm American with Middle Eastern roots. In the Middle East, I'm American with vague regional background. People who see me on television constantly speculate where I'm from. Is she half French, half Kurdish? I think she's American. No, I'm pretty sure she's Armenian. Trust me, she's Polish. Hey, Poland! I'm representing you, even though I'm not Polish, but it doesn't. Now, because students graduating today come from 68 countries, 68 countries! This is, it's like a model UN. You will probably feel a connection with this. When I started out in journalism, the probability that with a name and background and not so placeable accent like mine would be an asset on an American news network didn't even seem possible. But I realized soon that not only was it possible, it's what helped me become a better journalist. Different was good. Different means you are not forgettable. It means you are your own unique individual with your own personal blueprint. At some point, you realize your difference is, in fact, your biggest strength. Please cultivate it and be proud of it. And today, you are all here. I'm, first of all, impressed by that. On my graduation day, it took quite a bit of effort to get out of bed before noon, but so, well done. You're either looking forward to or dreading the next chapter, and that is, of course, the big job search. On this particular point, there's only one piece of advice I can give you that I'm certain of. When you consider your next job, think of the money last. Not just because it's the best way to make more money, I'll have more on that in a moment, but it will guarantee you as little workplace frustration and unhappiness as possible. It is the truth, but bear with me. There's a whole demonstration here. It's short. I, of course, never became a journalist to be rich. There's a reason no one has ever said, I'm going to travel to Cairo and sleep in a youth hostel and sell 600-word articles to BuzzFeed so I can make the Forbes 500 list. Nobody's ever said that, and nobody ever will. Journalism is a passion. You do it because you can't imagine doing anything else. You do it because you fundamentally believe you can bring important stories to readers or viewers and perhaps even change some perceptions along the way. On a really good day, and this is a 20-year career here that I'm considering, you come close to making a difference. In career-defining moments, you make that difference. And those memories stay with you in more precious ways than you can imagine. But what applies to a career in journalism applies to all careers. Do what you love. Do what you would consider doing for free, but never do it for free. Unless you intern for 3 years like me, but that's, still get paid per article. Which brings me to my second point. It is more important to negotiate your role than your compensation. The boss says, we will offer you this amount of money, and you say, awesome, I accept. But here's what I want. I would like a guarantee I manage this project. I want 2 weeks paid vacation in the summer because I want to go to Thailand, and you just can't do Thailand in 1 week. I want to work with this team that's doing this amazing thing. Did I mention that I accept your first salary offer? And it works. What ends up happening if you get even half of what you've asked for is that you will probably end up doing something that makes you happy. Not in the beginning, something that pays well. And when you do something that makes you happy, you do it well. And when you do something well, something miraculous happens. You get eventually paid more money. This is just a different and somewhat circuitous way of saying, be passionate about your work. In my career, I've always considered the money last, because what mattered to me and what still matters to me, even in the age of BuzzFeed and 140-character tweets and YouTube videos, is to make a difference. to bring a story to viewers they were unaware of, or to help them understand something happening overseas. I still have such a romantic notion of what my mission is in this business that you could say I'm practically disconnected from reality. I'm still a foolish girl in love with a job that doesn't always return my calls or meet my expectations, but that's what love is, blind faith that we are meant to be. And finally, a word about the hard times. Inevitably, life will throw sadness and disappointment your way, but you will be able to get through it and maybe even come out stronger. I mentioned earlier that I'm originally Syrian. There was a time in the United States when so few people knew where Syria even was that someone actually asked me how cold it was in Siberia. And I said, really, really cold. Like, you need a North Face jacket. But today, for all the tragic reasons that we all know, 4 years of a savage war, Syria is known to all. Every single Syrian is a victim in one way or another, either bombed by their own government or chased away by fanatics. Watching Syria unravel is like watching a loved one die from a terminal disease you can do nothing to cure. But I have seen more resilience in the face of what I never in my worst nightmares thought a single person can endure. And yet people choose to go on. And believe me, if they can, anyone can, and we all can. It has also taught me to appreciate what I have and what you all have is so precious today. A family that loves you, a good education, an excellent education, and the freedom to make choices. And if in doubt, always remember the wise words of Mel Brooks. Look, I don't want to wax philosophic, he said. But I will say that if you're alive, you've got to flap your arms and legs. You've got to jump around a lot. For life is the very opposite of death. And therefore, you must at the very least think noisy and colorfully, or you are not alive. So think noisy, think colorfully. And to all of you, I wish good luck. You made it. Now go celebrate.
That was just right.